Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have Kevin and Lisa Cotter. I'll reflect on the fruits of the Spirit and much more. Welcome to Life on the Rock. Tonight, our guests are Kevin and Lisa Cotter. They're telling us about the amazing parish program where they go in and help a priest form a leadership team made up of lay people to help lead the parish in evangelizing and functioning better as a parish. Now, Lisa talks about especially about her role as a mom in bringing people into the family to help evangelize them there and walking alongside her and just seeing what family life's all about and what they do. It makes it seem very doable.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and God's blessed us with many gifts and talents. And even for Kevin and Lisa, one of the ministries they have is that they invite people over to their house and they share communion and lead Bible studies. And that's just a great example of one way we can build faith.
Right. And I also shot a video up at the shrine about the fruits of the Spirit. So we hope you enjoy that. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Galatians 5. Peace is a fruit of the Spirit. And Paul is telling us that we've received the Holy Spirit in baptism, confirmation. Now we also have to walk, we have to live by that Spirit, meaning we have to depend upon that Spirit. I remember one time when I was praying, I was asking God, what's the solution to sin? How do I get out of sin in my life? And I turned to this Galatians 5 passage about walking by the Spirit, depending on God. You know, sin just burns that house of peace down to the ground. If you want to lose your peace, go commit sin. That steals our peace, absolutely. But sometimes we think the solution to that is just to try harder, my own efforts. Paul is telling us to walk by the Spirit, to depend on God, that we can't overcome sin without His grace, that we need the Holy Spirit to work in us, that we need to live by a new power to overcome sin and to have God's peace. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus, keep walking towards Him, even though we fall and stumble, get up again, walking by the Spirit, focus on the Lord. That's how we combat sin. That's how we overcome sin in our life. May the Lord give you His peace. Welcome, Lisa and Kevin Cotter,
hey,
to Life on the Rock.
Great to be here. Yeah.
Now, you're part of something new. You were with Focus. Now you're with the Amazing Parish. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so the Amazing Parish awakens and empowers pastors to build amazing parishes. And one of the main ways we do that is just really trying to call pastors into leadership and then form a team, a leadership team around them in their parish to really shoulder the responsibility, not the authority of leading a parish, but the responsibility of leading a parish, so that parish can't just worry about mission or taking care of, you know, maintenance around their parish, but really lead them into mission. It really takes that leadership team to help get the direction from the pastor and then lead. So that's what Amazing Parish is all about.
Right. And what do you, I've had families ask me this, like devout families, they hear all this stuff about evangelization, outreach. What is a busy family, kids, what are they supposed to do? How do they participate in that mission? Certainly, you know, in the amongst themselves, there's the mission, but also outward.
Yeah, I think it's always an interesting balance with a family because, you know, with family life, you're really trying to get your kids to learn about God themselves before you go out and be like, hey, we're going to share that with other people. So I think it really starts with our own prayer lives and making sure that we're really living out a relationship with God, that they see that relationship with us. And then once that's intact as a family, it's inviting people into that. So for us, it's, you know, we're living the liturgical year. We're having a St. Joseph's Day party. We're inviting, you know, friends. They could be Catholic, non-Catholic, over to our house, and they get to experience that as our kids, people coming into our house. And then also just small group Bible studies. They're seeing the people that are coming into our home. They're seeing mom and dad model what it looks like to lead a Bible study, to share Jesus with people, to see people change their lives, things like that. So I think as a family, it's really just living out that pursuit of a relationship with God, and your kids seeing that, and then seeing you also tell other people about it, and they, I think just over time they pick up on what mom and dad are doing and how it all works.
Because I would think that's really critical to have an amazing parish would be, to rouse all the troops, so to speak, to have that move outward. And
yeah.
I mean, we have to heal within, but and work on that. But I know Pope Francis is always talking about that. If you want to be a healthy church, it needs to be not, going to them that need it, know, in outreach. So.
Yeah, he says parishes are supposed to be missionary centers. And so I think for a lot of our parishes, especially in our day and age of having so few priests, it's really difficult. A lot of these priests have not only one parish by themselves, but two or three. And so that's where if that leadership team comes around them and shares that responsibility, that parish can now get a group of people, a leadership team, that then can help them go on mission. And then the lady in their parish go, all right, we have a mission. We have a direction. We're not just trying to maintain our parish.
Right.
And they can
maintain,
join along.
Yeah.
They can join alongside them and see that mission actually take place and happen in their parish.
And I've heard a lot on Life on the Rock, families having that openness, that hospitality to welcome others. And it seemed like moms are so critical to that. Especially like singles can come and plug into a family, maybe have a meal. Have you all experienced that?
Yeah, and we experienced that as college students, where we were at Benedictine College. The professors would have us into their homes. And for us, that was so formative because we're both the youngest. I have one sibling, Kevin has two. So we never saw family life with young kids and the messiness of it. So to be able to go into their homes was huge, to see, this is what it's really like. It's not just, it's so fun and babies are easy and no, it's kind of chaotic. And that was helpful for us to see. And so then we try to do that too, now that we're parents and we have kids, to have our home be a place that's welcoming, where singles can come in and kind of see family life and its reality and kind of pass on what was given to us.
And I think that's the most common form of evangelization, is like just the family being true to itself, witnessing to gospel love, gospel life. I mean, that calls people, because we all want mm-hmm. that in our hearts.
Yeah, and as a mom now, like, time is very limited, so it's kind of like, come alongside what I'm already doing, because I can't, leave the house and, multiple times a week be having one-on-one individual hour-long conversations with people like I could in college, which is how I did it. But now it's more, it's got to be in the context of community for us.
Yeah. So the Amazing Parish is also trying to help set up some structures that will serve that mission. And can you give us a little more practical, like what would that look like in the parish?
Yeah, so it looks like typically a pastor has a leadership team. So these are people typically on his staff that can work through their day-to-day in the parish. They're actually getting the parish life done. And so he meets with that group on a weekly basis, and they're setting the strategy for what that parish looks like. So they're looking at their Sunday experience. What are our homilies looking like this weekend? What's the hospitality look like? How are we doing music really well? And they're constantly looking at, how do we make things better? What does it look like to reach people on the peripheries and bring them into our church? If someone showed up, what would that experience be like? That core team is there with Father saying, how do we make this experience as best as possible? And you sort of, with that team, have that missionary center, that missionary team right then and there of people who are so excited that they go, man, I want to make this parish awesome. And from that core team, all of a sudden you see the rest of the staff can align to that mission. You can see the rest of the volunteers and the lady also join and go, how do we make this parish awesome and amazing? So yeah, that's what it a lot of times looks like.
And I wonder too, like, with so many, both mom, dad oftentimes are working and things, and so many women are in the workforce. A lot of women volunteer at the parish. They can bring those workforce skills of administration, organization. I would imagine that would be a big help to the pastor. You get someone with those kind of skills. Because I find there's a lot of people in the parish that want to help, they're just not organized.
Yeah, that's, I think, a lot about our founding. Pat Lencioni, he's one of our co-founders, he's New York Times bestseller. Forbes calls him top five business speakers in the world. And so I think for him, as someone in the parish, he has all this experience of coaching people, executives at Southwest Airlines or Chick-fil-A. And so he goes to his own parish and it's like, all right, these same principles that I teach work Fortune 500 companies, they work for sports teams, they work for organizations. Certainly they can work for parishes as well. And parishes aren't businesses, but they're organizations that need similar structures and leadership and teams just like anyone else. And why not use it here? And so I think, Pat had that same mentality. And there's so many other great folks in our parishes that are so business savvy and minded that we can add these things to our parishes and make them come alive. Because oftentimes, as good as a heart is for evangelization, some of the structures aren't in place. There's only so much time in a day. There's only so many people to do work, right. And things aren't aligned to actually get into mission because we're so, we don't have the structure to do it.
Stuck in the weeds.
Yeah.
Stuck in the day-to-day, you know, nitty-gritty, and you don't do what you really want to do, which is be out there with people.
Yeah. I've seen in our diocese back home, we have a lot of permanent deacons. I think we just ordained like 20-something, and they all have like military backgrounds, great business backgrounds, and we've had a chance to work with these deacons, and they bring a great gift to the church.
About structure.
It's just, I always think that's kind of the American gift to Catholicism too, you know, to come up with these structures and stuff. You know, something else I wanted to ask you all about, you've written and spoken on relationships and dating. I hear all the time, Father, how do I meet somebody? What do you tell people, Lisa, about these young people want to get married, they have trouble finding somebody?
The first thing I tell them is, it's hard. I'm so sorry. Because it is. It's so hard right now. Things look so different than they did. It used to be our parish communities were a lot stronger, a lot more, you know, together, and your community is kind of where you look to find your spouse. And now people are so dispersed, and it's very different. So you have to be more creative and you have to be more intentional. And it means sometimes making a sacrifice. You might need to drive to get to that Catholic young adult event. And I know sometimes those get a little bit of a bad rap. It's like, oh, that's just like the Catholic meat market, you know? It's like, well, I don't want to go there.
Yeah.
But you have to go where the people are that you want to meet.
I heard one Protestant pastor say, you know, unless you're going to marry the UPS man, you got to get out there and meet
that's
people.
That's right, yeah. Especially because so many people are working from home now, too, you know, and they're not getting out. And so I think you have to be intentional. You have to find that Bible study, even if that means driving a bit.
Yeah.
And we also have found a lot of people have had success through online dating websites. And one of my best friends found her husband through, I think it was Catholic Singles.
Are we still kind of sheepish? My generation definitely.
Yeah.
It's like online.
Yeah.
But it's much, I heard like a quarter of marriages today started online.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that stigma's kind of gone away. At least I think more and more people are open to it because they've grown up online.
Yeah.
And so they're like, well, that's how I was with my, you know, talked to my friends in junior high was through Facebook. Like, so there's more a comfortable feeling with it. But you know, you got to be smart about it, and not everybody on all those sites is, you know, exactly what you're looking for. But it's all a part of the process, and it's being intentional. I think sometimes we think, well, I'll just sit here and wait, and God will bring the perfect person. And no, we actually have to kind of be more intentional now than ever before.
Yeah, I think the same is true of religious life. You know, we give advice, hey, go visit these communities. You know, and God works with that. He guides us, and there's that cooperation with our action and His, you know, His Holy Spirit working. You know, I remember years ago reading, hearing you talk about some of the temptations sometimes for women in the relationship is emotional use, and this just blew the doors off of my world. I never thought of it. You speak a lot to young women. What do you tell them about that? That there's like an emotional kind of modesty even, right, in the relationship, that there's something that's proper to marriage, even emotionally, you know, it doesn't begin before marriage.
And there's so much I could say on that. I think that especially for those that are solid Catholics and they're like, I'm doing everything right, like my relationships are pure and chaste, but I'm still having so much trouble. Oftentimes I say, well, how are things on the emotional side, like how are you handling things emotionally? And I think that it's easy for the emotions to get a little twisted because we are so in love with the idea of love that sometimes rather than love being something where we're trying to will somebody's good, we're trying to fill a void.
Right.
And so there's ways we can use each other emotionally, whether that be as like a security blanket, you know, like, oh, if I just have a relationship, or, you know, we expect somebody to be our savior in a relationship, it can twist something good, this desire to have companionship in a relationship, into something that's not necessarily pointing towards the good anymore because you're just trying to fill a void, and so you're using this person. So there's many ways that really we can do this, and JP2 talks about this a lot in Love and Responsibility, the way that the emotions can get twisted in relationships. And I think that's something we need to be aware of and needs to be talked about, because sometimes that's the key behind why things aren't working so well.
Yeah, I know the theme that we've talked a lot about in the interviews this weekend too is just you know, a lot of this stuff's made for marriage. You know, you can't start, you know, you can't have this complete openness before marriage, you know, and it, so it's healthy, it works in the context of this committed lifelong relationship.
Yeah, I'll sometimes use the analogy of like the temple. At the time, you know, the temple of Jesus' time had these different courts, and depending on who you were, depending on how close you could get to the center, to the heart of hearts, the holy of holies, and it's kind of like our hearts, like we need to be aware of who we're letting in, to how close they're getting to the intimacy of us. And there are some places that are reserved for marriage. And
right.
I think sometimes we just desperately want to have a connection. Yeah. And it's like, I'll just throw open all the curtains and just come on in. Yeah. And then it doesn't feel so sacred in there anymore when so many people know all the intimacies of your heart. And so, yeah, there needs to be a proper progression of emotional intimacy as a relationship gets closer, and some things aren't saved for marriage.
Yeah, and it seems like the technology of our culture is so quickly advancing, the culture itself that protects and grows up around the human person can't stay with it. And so we have to find community, we have to humanize it, find ways of relating. Do you see that? That's one of the things I like about Focus too. You see young people incarnating the gospel in their life. Do you see like this revival maybe of a healthier culture of interaction and stuff in your work? Or
I think so. I think what Focus does that's amazing is they build community. And I think so often people feel so isolated, and they think they're having human interaction and connection because they're looking at on their phones, you know, it's like, oh, well, I, you know, caught up on their life because I watched their Instagram story or their Snapchat feed. It's like, well, that's not a real connection. Real connections happen face to face. And so what Focus does is it really works on, we're going to get together for Bible study. We're going to go out to a coffee. We're going to have the face-to-face interaction. That's a key to how they build relationships.
And I think when in that culture, there's such a hunger for it. So then when you encounter someone who lives real life, who invites you into that life, that says, this is what it looks like day to day, week to week, month to month, people go, oh my gosh, here's someone who actually can show me life. Someone who I don't just see a fake image on social media, or just, you know, it's something from a movie, but it's actual, like you said, incarnate. So whether it's a family viewing that, whether it's just the faith viewing that, it's so important that people see that in real life, because they're hungry for it because they don't have it.
Yeah, there's something about that presence of each human person that you just got to be brought together, you know?
Yeah.
That, there's something that happens there. But, well, thank you so much for talking with us.
Thanks,
it's great to
appreciate
see you
it.
All again.
Thanks for having us.
Awesome. Good to see you.
Well, I always enjoy speaking with Lisa and Kevin Cotter. Lisa's so sweet, and she's got a great history. I know she worked with Focus and everything. And I think they have a great program trying to mobilize all the talents, abilities, giftings in the parish to work in conjunction with the pastor. You can't do it yourself. You have so few priests. You absolutely need the laity to mobilize and take initiative.
Right? We have even seen today, like you mentioned earlier, that a number of deacons, even in our diocese, have really contributed a lot to a lot of parish renewal today. We see even an increase in just with the laity, too. Really taking an initiative to help others build faith, build community, and really working with each other. And I know even in my own experience as a teen, I worked with many great people who were involved with the parish. And I always remember that really touched me, you know, as a teenager, that these were people with very genuine faith.
Right. So we all have gifts and talents. Yeah. We have gifts and talents on a natural level. We have giftings by the Holy Spirit. And the beautiful thing in the church is that, you know, God's inspiring us, and the Holy Spirit is mobilizing and organizing the mystical body, that we can all bring our gifts, serve others, and build up the body of Christ, as St. Paul talks about. So I think it fits well with the video we had about walking by the Spirit to have His peace, but also, you know, walking by the Spirit to serve and to use those gifts we've been given.
And now what I like about Lisa and Kevin's story is that, you know, they're married and they have a family, but they invite people to their house to share in fellowship and really to lead Bible studies and let others who are discerning marriage see what marriage is about. You know, it's a great witness to our faith.
I like what she said too. It's not about like doing something new as a married person, but just letting people in maybe to see, you know, what marriage is about, what it's really about.
Because there's a lot of distortions out there in our culture.
Right, so she just had let them come and see. So our End of the Vineyard challenge is to take initiative, you know, to take action, to pray, to ask God, show me your will. How can I give what I've been given? How can I share what I have? The world needs it. Your parish needs it. Your family needs it. Your community needs it. And we have to make that effort to give of ourselves. And that's how we truly find ourselves. That's how we discover ourselves, is through giving and through service. So we send you into that vineyard with a blessing, and ask the Holy Spirit to come upon you, to strengthen you and guide you, and to enable you to use all the gifts that you've been given. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Giving new sight.